when I had nothing left, I could still walk. But the mana had run dry, sputtering feebly from my fingertips. There's only so much a mage with a young spark can do before the plane he's on swallows him like a Sumetian leviathan. So you just walk and hope. I needed an ally. Someone to show me what it meant to be a planeswalker. Someone who had been tapped out and dead on board, but managed to break through the wall of defeat and truly rule a plane the way planeswalkers know they should. I needed a deckmaster. I needed a champion.
Are you alright?
I needed Finkel.
What drove you guys to work together in preparing for this event?
I've known John for a long time. You know, we tested together, you know, 10, 12 years ago, you know, for tournaments.
Yeah, maybe so, even more.
Yeah, seriously. Yeah, we actually tested together, although it was mostly John's deck, the prison deck. Yeah, I also played that deck too.
The best deck I ever played.
You know, so I mean, we've worked together in the past. So it's not like this is just sort of out of nowhere.
That was in 97.
Cool. Yeah.
That's 15 years ago.
15 years ago.
Wow.
We're old men.
Yeah. I'm older. He's manlier.
You can tell.
In an event with only 16 players, teaming up with three of your competitors might seem strange, especially, you know, given the likelihood that you'll play against each other. Why'd you make the decision to nonetheless prepare as a team?
I mean, it helps all of us. It helps all of our chances to be working together and improve our deck. And we're all friends. We all want each other to do well in the tournament.
You think it still helps everybody, even if there's a little bit of individual sacrifice, should you get paired up against one of your teammates?
It's not individual sacrifice. As a group, like, we all are individually going to do better from having worked with each other.
Do you guys all feel that way?
I think you have a competitive advantage when you have 2 to 4 people as opposed to one. One is way worse than any other number. So I don't think we would want to split into smaller groups.
Because the rest of the players are the best players in the world, what skill set or advantage do you have that you think could put you on top and win the event? Welcome to the first ever Magic the Gathering Players Championship, where the 16 best Magic players from the last year square off for 3 days to fight for their share of $100,000 in cash and for the glory of being named Player of the Year. A lot of articles in the Magic blogosphere recently about the zone. You've won a Pro Tour. Were you in the zone at that Pro Tour?
I think I definitely was. I was kind of outside myself. I wasn't, you know, I was just playing Magic, not thinking about playing Magic, if that makes any sense. It's very zen-like state, kind of, that you're just, you know, you're just in the moment entirely, you're not thinking about, you know, whether you're going to win the tournament, or if you win this match, are you going to, you know, you're playing this one game for $20,000 or something. That doesn't cross your mind. You're just like, okay, what does he have? What am I going to play? And you're just entirely focused. And I think it's you have to kind of practice, but you also have to let go at the same time, I think, to get there.
Is that something you felt like you've been in?
Without using terms like the zone, which I think are, like, incredibly lame, yeah, I think it's true. Just, like, being like really confident is just, it just does wonders. Like when you don't have to second guess yourself all the time, when you know, like you're confident you're going to win, you're confident in your plays, you just play way better and you expect to win, and then you do.
Do you feel as though you've experienced the zone? Is that like a real thing?
I mean, I don't think it's a real thing. I mean, look, to be clear, I'm not saying it's 0%. I'm not saying at the margins there's not a slight difference where on some day maybe someone's playing a little better and they're going to play another day. But usually I think it's just the brain kind of looking back after the fact, and like all of their decisions, you know, are working out right. Really, I'm just feeling it because I was winning. I wasn't winning because I was feeling it.
So flow is a psychological state that's usually experienced as positive by people, in which they lose track of time and they get completely absorbed in what they're doing. But actually, in addition to that, one thing that's really important is that the experience of flow is characterized by both high levels of challenges and also high levels of skills. Flow, most scientists would argue, probably does contribute to achievement in the sense that when you're in flow, the level of challenges that you're facing matches the level of skills that you have. So in a sense, you're constantly challenging yourself a little bit, but you have the skills to meet that challenge. And you challenge yourself again, and you have the skills to meet that challenge. And so theoretically, when you're in flow, you should actually be improving in whatever you're doing. So yes, flow should eventually lead to being able to do whatever you're doing better.
One reason I'm personally excited for this event is the tournament debut of a format called Cube Draft, in which the players improvise their decks, building them on the fly, one card at a time, from a randomly shuffled collection of some of the most powerful spells in Magic's history. It's my favorite way to play at home with my friends, and so it's really awesome to see it played on the big stage. This is Tom LaPilli. He is the man who designed and put together the cube. When you are deciding which cards go into the cube, what sort of criteria are you looking at?
I tried first to pick cards that I like, and second to pick an experience that I want to have. So for the Magic Online cube here, what we were going for was to replicate the experience of playing every constructed format in the history of Magic all at the same time, which happens to include a lot of cards that we like, which was fortunate.
Brian, if you had to put the strategy of your deck into a sentence, what would it be?
Trying to figure that right now.
Aggressive.
My strategy?
Yeah.
Just decks?
Yeah.
You play your early threats, and then you have cheap spells or answer to expensive spells, like counter spells and stuff like that. Hopes to prey on the decks that go like mana acceleration, bomb, because you do like do to counter the bomb and then you're way ahead. But theoretically, at least.
At 5-4 now?
I am.
So 5-4 is not a great record at a normal Pro Tour after 9 rounds.
It's also not a great record here.
Oh, I was going to ask. How do you feel are your chances for the rest of the day?
I mean, I think I'm probably about 50-50 each round. So, if I have to go 3-0 to make the Final Four, I'm probably about 1-8 to do so.
So do you need to go into the zone to make it to the end, or do you need to win a bunch of coin flips?
I need to win a bunch of metaphorical coin flips. Although, you know, look, if the zone gods are out there and you want to give me the zone, hey, you know, I'll take it.
Shota Yasuoka is a 28-year-old game designer from Shinjuku, Japan. A lone wolf known as one of the game's most innovative and successful deck builders, he dominated the field with an 11-1 record. Given the level of competition and the stakes involved, his performance at this tournament will be remembered as one of the greatest displays of mastery in Magic's history. Paolo Vitor D'Amadorosa is a 24-year-old student majoring in international relations in Porto Alegre, Brazil. He enjoys Broadway musicals, is an ardent fan of the Brazilian national women's volleyball team, and is perhaps the most dominant Magic player of the last 7 years. Tokyo resident Yuya Watanabe calls playing Magic his occupation and is one of Japan's most popular and beloved players. At age 23, he's won an astounding 6 Grand Prix tournaments, just one fewer than the all-time record holder Kai Buda. Jon Finkel is a 34-year-old managing partner at a New York City hedge fund and recently founded a charity called Gamers Helping Gamers to grant college scholarships to promising young Magic players. The original megastar of competitive Magic in the 1990s, he is widely considered the greatest and most talented player of all time. But all the talent in the world couldn't help Finkel against the seemingly unstoppable Shota Yasuoka, who was able to shut down Finkel's attack with a wizard and a shaman that allowed him to cast and recast the smotheringly defensive spell Cryptic Command. In 3 swift games, he vanquished the New Yorker, leaving him one match away from the title.
I mean, there were definitely points in game 1 where I felt like I was a favorite. I didn't end up winning. You know, I felt like, you know, the various decisions I made, you know, tended to not really work out, but, you know, that's, you know, I mean, his deck's good against me, he's an excellent player, and,
what are you gonna do?
Yeah, you know, look, I'm still happy to, you know, come in 4th place, you know.
Win $10,000.
$10,000 on a, you know, week when I went 7 wins and 6 losses.
Meanwhile, Paolo Vitor D'Amadorosa was putting up as good a fight as he could with his menagerie of violent apes and cats. But Yuya Watanabe's counterattack, led in large part by these troublesome kitchen monsters, proved too much for the Brazilian and paved the way for Yuya to meet his countrymen in the finals. Shota has been almost unbeatable in this tournament. Do you think you can beat him? In the finals, both players came out swinging, only to see their creatures die in combat or killed with lightning bolts. But just when calm had been restored to the battlefield, Yuya put away game 1 in the best of 5 with the brutal 1-2 punch of an elf berserker and the famously sadistic Liliana of the Veil. But Shota struck back to win game 2 with an aerial assault by a clique of fairy wizards, as well as his trademark recursive use of the Cryptic Command. But while Shota mounted a formidable army in game 3, it just served as an all-you-can-eat buffet for Yuya's legendary vampire, Olivia Voldaren, who systematically consumed Shota's army until she grew to an immense 14 power and toughness, and proved too powerful for Shota to overcome. With his back to the wall, Shota got off to a good start in game 4, and took control of the game for good when he ambushed Yuya's ape by pouring a liquefied essence from this vial onto the battlefield, from which a horrific monster instantly appeared. But Yuya unleashed that same horrific monster himself in the final and decisive game 5, and while Shota furiously defended himself with lightning bolts, the assault proved too powerful, leaving Yuya Watanabe to stand alone with the trophy, the $40,000 check, and the historic honor of his second earning of the title, Player of the Year. What was the most important decision you made in the match?
Last game, final game, no, turn 3, de, Tadamogoi who played that one.
And why was that an important decision?
It's a very risky play, de, Yasuoka が 1 mana 立たせてたんで Desperate Snare に 引っかかる可能性があるし、 返しで Yasuoka 3 mana になるんで、 スレッツで 普通の 糸で パクられる可能性もある。
Congratulations, Yuya Watanabe!
the 2012 Player of the Year.
Thank you.
And so, it is down to you, and down to me.
In that case, I challenge you to a duel.
To the death? I accept.
Smell these, but do not touch.
I smell nothing.
What you do not smell are so-called dirtle decks. They are odorless, creatureless, and contain no win conditions of any kind. This card is called Battle of Wits, and is one of the more powerful spells known to man. It will only go in one of the decks, and the game ends when one of us casts it, and the other dies. Which deck has the Battle of Wits? You choose, and we play.
But it is so simple. All I have to do is divine from what I know of you. Are you the type of player that put the spell in his own deck or into his enemies? Now, a clever man would put the spell into his enemy's deck, for he knows only a great fool would play with the deck that was given to him. But I am no great fool, so I must not play with your deck. But I know that you know that I am not a great fool, so clearly then I cannot play with my own deck.
Truly, you have a dizzying intellect.
Have you ever heard of Jon Finkel? Aaron Forsyth? Richard Garfield?
Yes.
Moron.
You're stalling. You're trying to trick me into giving away something. It won't work.
But it has! You've given me everything! I know exactly where the card is!
Then make your choice!
I will! And I choose... Is that Dave Williams?
What? David Williams? What? Where? I don't see him.
I could have sworn that I saw him. No matter. Well, why don't we battle? Me with my deck, and you with yours.
You guessed wrong.
Ha! You only think I guessed wrong! I switched for libraries when your back was turned. Ha ha, you fool! You fell victim to one of the classic blunders, the most famous of which is never design a three-powered flying one-drop in blue. But slightly lesser known, but equally important, is this. Never go up against Maro when death is on the line!
Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm okay.